In this video, we'll learn how to implement policy-based authorization in a Blazor application. We'll assign different permissions such as view, add, edit, and delete to various users. You can access the source code of this project by supporting us on Patreon. Let's get started. I've created a new Blazor project called Blazor Policy Auth. This project uses server interactive render mode and per page or component interactivity location. I'm using a SQL Server database and the connection string is provided in the app settings. In this application, we have a products module where we can view, add, edit, and delete products. Currently, there are no products added, so let's add one. The product was added successfully. Now, let's try to edit the product. I have updated the product price. We also have a delete option. As you can see, the product is now deleted. Now, let's implement the view, add, edit, and delete permissions using user policies. We should be able to provide the necessary permissions for different users. First, let's create an entity class for user accounts. I'll assign a table name for this entity. We'll start by adding the ID property. We'll provide the attributes to denote that it is the key, database-generated identity, and a custom column name as we usually do. Next, let's add the username and password properties with custom column names and a maximum allowed length. Now, let's add another entity class for user account policies. We'll also include the ID property here. Then, we'll map the user account ID. After that, we'll include a property for the user policy. Finally, we'll add a Boolean property to indicate whether the permission is allowed or not. We'll provide the attributes to assign a custom table name, custom column names, and attributes for the ID property. Now that our entity classes are ready, let's add the DB sets in our database context class. We already have the DB set for the product entity. Let's add the DB sets for the user account and user account policy as well. Now it's time to create the pages needed for the authentication process. Before creating the login page, we'll create a view model for it. I'll name it Login View Model. We only need two properties, username and password. I'll also add the required attribute for both properties. Next, I'll create a folder named Account inside the Pages folder. Then I'll create the login page inside the new folder. First, let's assign the URL using the page directive. We'll place an edit form here. Before that, let's declare the login view model object. I'll assign the supply parameter from form attribute since we need to receive values from the form. Now, let's place the edit form. We need a method to be called during the form submission, which I'll name authenticate. We can also provide a form name. Inside the form, I'll place the necessary components, including the input elements for the username and password. Additionally, we'll display an error message here, which we'll declare as a private variable. Since we are implementing the cookie-based authentication, we need the HTTP context object, which we can get as a cascading parameter. Now, let's implement the authenticate method. First, we'll check whether the username or password is blank and display an error message if either is empty. Next, we need to fetch the user account from the database. So, we'll inject the database context for that purpose. We'll filter the user account by provided username and display an error if the user account is null or if the password doesn't match. If everything is correct, we'll proceed to create the claims. Initially, we'll include the username in the claims. Next, we'll include the user account policies in the claims as well, which we'll do shortly. Once the claims are prepared, we'll create a claims identity object by providing the claims and specifying the authentication scheme for cookie authentication. Then, we'll create a claims principal object using the identity. Finally, we'll use the sign-in async method of HTTP context to authenticate the user. We'll also inject Navigation Manager so that we can redirect the user to the home page after successful authentication. Now, let's add the policies to the claims. We'll fetch the policies from the database by filtering with a user account ID and ensuring the isEnabled property is true. Next, we'll add each policy with a value of true to the claims. To ensure the view model is not null during loading, we'll add the new keyword here. Additionally, we'll add the data annotation validator inside the edit form so that it displays error messages for the required attributes defined in the login view model. Next, we can create a page for logout, which will redirect the user once they are logged out. Let's set the page URL to /logout. I'll provide a sample design where the user sees a message saying you have successfully logged out. We'll need the HTTP context object, which we can obtain from the cascading parameter. Then, we'll override the onInitialized async method. Inside this method, we'll first check if the user is authenticated. If they are, we'll use the signout async method of HTTP context to sign them out. Next, we'll inject Navigation Manager and redirect the user back to the same page with force load enabled. This ensures all components are refreshed. Next, let's create another page named Access Denied. This page is necessary for scenarios where an authenticated user attempts to access unauthorized pages. I'll show you how it works shortly. Here is the design for the page. It will display a message saying you don't have permission to access this page. Now, in our program class, let's include the necessary services. First, we'll add the authentication service by specifying the scheme as cookie authentication defaults.authentication scheme. Then, we'll configure some options in the add cookie method. We'll provide a custom name for the cookie and set the login path so that the application redirects an unauthenticated user to the login page when attempting to access pages that require authentication. Additionally, we'll set an expiration time for the cookie using the max age property. I'll set it to 30 minutes. Finally, we'll assign the access denied path to the URL of our access denied page. Now, let's add a class named UserPolicy. I'll create string constants for the permissions we need. Additionally, I'll create a static method to retrieve all the permissions as a list. Now, let's return to the program class and add the authorization service, where we'll configure some settings. We'll loop through all the permissions fetched using the static method we created earlier. Within this loop, we'll add each policy and specify the required claim. Additionally, we'll need to add cascading authentication state to the dependency services. Another important step is to change the route view to authorize route view in the routes.razor component. Now we can begin adjusting our pages to meet our specific needs. Within the nav menu component, there is a menu option labeled product. However, we want to restrict this option to users who have the view permission. To achieve this, we'll move it inside an authorize view tag. To use this namespace across multiple pages, I'm relocating it to the imports.razor file. Now, within this authorize view tag, we'll specify the required policy. Let's relocate the menu option to the authorized section to ensure it's only visible to the authorized users. In the main layout, we can dynamically display login and logout options based on the authentication status. Authorized users will see the logout option, while unauthorized users will see a login option. Next, on the home page, we can display the username if the user is authenticated. On the products page, we have input elements for adding a new product. These elements will only be displayed if the user has add permission. Now, this component represents a row item in the product table. Here, we have edit and delete options that should only be visible to users with necessary permissions. Let's implement this functionality as well. Next, we'll implement data seeding in our database context class to ensure we have the necessary data for testing the application. I'll begin by overriding the onModelCreating method. Inside this method, I'll add some demo products using modelBuilder.entityOfProduct.hasData to seed them into the database. Similarly, I'll create demo user accounts and include user account policies for these accounts. The first user will have no permissions. The second user can only view products. The third user can view and add products. The fourth user can view, add, and edit products. And the fifth user will have all the permissions. Let's proceed to add the migration. If you are downloading the source code from our Patreon page, you can simply modify the connection string in the app settings and provide the update database command. The database update process has been completed successfully. We can now see all the three tables populated with the demo products, user accounts, and user account policies. Now let's test the application. I log in with user 1. As expected, we do not see the products menu option. If I attempt to access the page directly via URL, it displays the custom access denied page that we created. Now let's log out and log in with user 2, who can only view the products. Next, we'll try with the third user, who has permission to view and add products. Let's go ahead and add a new product. Now, let's log in with the fourth user. You can see that the edit option is available for this user. Let's try editing a product. Finally, let's test with the last user who has the permission to delete the products as well. Let me also show you the authentication cookie. In the developer options, navigate to the application tab where you can find the cookie named as we specified earlier. If we delete this cookie, the user will be logged out automatically. I hope the concepts are clear to you now. You can access the source code of this project on our Patreon page. For further learning about Blazor, please explore our Blazor tutorial playlist. You can find the playlist link in the video description. Thanks for watching this video. If you found this video helpful, please like, share, and subscribe the channel. Happy coding!